Hi everyone, and welcome to today's Daily Star Facebook Live. So we're kicking off the Carly and Convo series with the wonderful Diane Youdale. Thanks for joining us today, Diane.
Thank you guys. Thank you everyone.
So I say Diane, but most people will generally know you as a different name, won't they?
Which yeah.
is Jet. So we're with Gladiators Jet today. Here's a lovely snap of her. We just had a look at the pictures, didn't we, Diane? The lovely pictures. Oh, we've got a little pose from you there. Oh, we've got a little, can we have a little pose? Can you still do it?
I can't quite recreate the cleavage. I mean, I could, but my polar neck's too tight and I would not even want to go there these days.
But arguably, you might not agree, but I think you were the most loved gladiator. You might not want to agree that yourself, but I've heard it. People tell me a lot. Now, Gladiators kicked off almost 30 years ago.
Which 30 years next year, yeah.
Next year should be celebrating that. Now, I'm only 25 myself, so I do remember my mum and dad watched it on a Saturday night. I'd pick up cushions, whack my dad over the head. So I went around for it all, but I did see a little bit. But I am aware of how big the fan base was, and there's still like such a following with all you glads now. Like, people are still so keen on what you're doing, what you're up to. So how did that sort of feel like going from like an overnight success, really?
It was weird because, oh gosh, people ask, you know, what it would be like today with social media and everything, and it would be that much bigger. But it was big at the time. I think it was dragging in like 14 million viewers on a primetime Saturday night, which is good for Saturday nights, even by today's standards. And it was an overnight success. I don't think any of us saw it coming. It was hard work, and I think it deserved its success because it wasn't an easy show to do. It looked like fun, looked very glamorous, but a little bit like Car Crash TV, it actually did hurt. You know, everything was padded, but not enough to not stave off what could have been quite serious and were quite serious injuries. But worth it, I think, all these years on, because it's as you said, it's fondly remembered.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I'd personally be cut out for it, so good on you. But overnight success also came with like overnight sex symbolness. You were upon, everyone loved you. I think everyone say you were the dad's favourite. Like, everyone knows you as like the sort of pin-up of the series. How did that feel? Like, that must have made you like even more confident though, I'm guessing.
I like to take my glasses off of that. I think, could I really? I'm just like Nana Muscuri. I'm sorry. I don't see. I think when you're inside yourself, you don't see yourself as other people might see you. I certainly didn't get it then, and I don't get it now. So it's in the eye of the beholder, Carly, as they say.
Well, that's very modest of you, but I can clearly say, probably with everyone watching as well, you've still got it now. You're just as stunning now. So I think you are clearly just very modest, because I can see it from here and we're through a screen.
You all need your testing, that's all I say.
How did that feel though? So obviously people knew you for your talent and they knew you for your good looks. So did you get sort of a big fan base? I know you had a fan club start at one point.
Oh, what? Sorry?
You had your own fan club, didn't you? Mail coming through the door.
No. Yeah. You're right. Your research is really good. So this is in the day before people could just pick up a phone and Insta or Facebook or Twitter, and you would actually get sacks, old-fashioned Hessian sacks, with Royal Mail around the sides of it, with literally handwritten, beautifully handwritten letters, cards, and other effects, which I won't go into. So people would make handicrafts at home and believe that it would actually survive the journey down to where I live in Surrey. And it was quite overwhelming. But then my mum, bless her, even back then said, I'll help you if you want. Oh. So I then would get all my mail directed back up to the northeast where I was originally from. But I was living in Surrey for many years. And she would actually go through a lot of it and keep the ones that had ever evidently had lots of heart, lots of thought through it. So it was really odd sort of receiving this overwhelming amount of handwritten sort of fan mail. We had a fan club. Yes, there was the Gladiator fan club, which LWT dealt with. There wasn't a separate Jet fan club from what I know, but the volume for all of us, I think, was pretty high. I'm not being modest. It was just it was a team effort of a show. And I think you had a different demographic, like the Spice Girls, for each member of the audience. People would have their favourites based on all the of different reasons. We had the baddie, we had the good looking boys, we had the sporty girls like myself and Lightning, who were ex-gymnasts. You had the very glamorous, long, tall athletes like Judy Simpson and Kate Staples, and Sharon Davis, of course, who were just already known in their own way. So there was a little bit of something for everybody.
I'm guessing you got quite a lot of mixed stuff sent to you. I'm guessing there could have been marriage proposals galore, anything weird and wonderful sent in the post that sort of stands out.
I did get a series of unicorns sent, and these unicorns were sort of handmade in plaster of Paris and quite badly painted. And so I called it the unicorn man, could have been a woman, I don't know, sort of became, and lots of balloons. don't ask what the balloons were about. I think my hotel room was once filled with balloons from floor to ceiling. I sort of opened the door and it was like something from a horror movie. I'm like, if you've got a balloon phobia, that is not the room you want to go into. The fans were great. I think there was nothing sordid or horrible ever sent. Or at least I don't know, because I've not been told. So
yeah, maybe Mum opened those ones anyway and just didn't let you know.
Yeah, something she's still not telling me to this day. She's 86 and I love her style.
Oh, bless her. Well, what else moving on to? What would you say is the best memory on the show? Because obviously you're on there for a few years. You've done a lot in that time.
My best memory, I'll have to say, I'm not like super competitive, but yeah, I was winning, because it was such a nerve-wracking thing to do. Because one, if you won, invariably it meant you were successful at the events, and the events, as I said, weren't always the easiest of things to do, and we had very little time to train up on them. So if you were good at the events, one, you would hopefully win, which is great for the ego in front of millions of people at the end of the TV screen on a Saturday night prime time. And two, it meant you weren't hurt, because there was a lot of injuries that sometimes the camera didn't see. And so it was a win-win either all ways. So winning for me and walking away from an event rather than being scraped off a mat somewhere was always my big plus and the best bit about the show. And then being able to take the gladiator kit off and go back to your hotel room, and particularly once the season had been finished filming and you were walking away with maybe a couple of fractured fingers and a split sort of ligament, but nothing more major than that. But there were a lot of broken bones and some spinal injuries, as I said. So for me, the best bit was winning and walking away uninjured.
Yeah, I mean, that's
that puts it into some context as to how
my whole body is like going through, like, I'm just imagining that sounds horrible, like going to work and knowing the likelihood that you're gonna get severely hurt. I think I'd call a sickie every day. I don't think that's So would you say that is the hardest part then, or the trickiest, most difficult part of being on Glad, was it the injuries?
It was for me. I think as the season went on and you had the contenders come in at the very beginning, particularly in years one and maybe two, but then after that, the contenders came in so pre-trained, so genned up on the events. So they were then going and training sports specifically for the events. So they were coming in harder, faster, stronger, quicker, in every single way, and mentally more prepared for the show. But for the first couple of years, us as gladiators, even though we had a little bit more exposure to practice on the events, we were a little bit more in control. But as I said, the series progressed, the years progressed, the injury rates went up because the fight became literally more intense, because there was nothing acted about the show. It was all, apart from Wolf, when he'd get a bit of a mood on, and that played up for the cameras. But I think that was the best bit, because he was just such a naturally good baddie. He didn't want to be the baddie, by the way, but he was a naturally good baddie. He just had that look about him, didn't he? But yes, nothing in terms of once that whistle went with John Anderson, and until the whistle went at the end of the 30 seconds or the minute, nothing could have been retaken or reshot, because basically there's a lot of money at the end of the show to win, and you can't rig things like that. Do you know what I mean? It was for real, and for me quite scary, but it was thrilling once we'd finished. I was so nervous, I can't tell you.
How would you normally unwind from a sort of gladiator battle going on? What's the process when you leave the studio?
Do you know what? We were put in a really beautiful hotel in Birmingham. I think it was the Hyatt Hilton. They didn't like us because we had all this like false you know, the false tan that you used to use in those days. It was called Pro-Tan, and it stank, for one. But you'd look like a piece of when you've been at school and you had litmus paper and you'd flick some ink on it, and it would sort of dilate away from the center and go through like auras, like different colors. This thing was layered with all sorts of colors in it to make sure your skin would carry a really dark color. I think bodybuilders still use it to this day, but it stank of tar. It was called Pro-Tan, you can imagine. And so we'd get back stinking of Pro-Tan and looking forward to a beautiful night at this hotel, although they didn't like us in the end. I think we changed all the sheets regularly because we must have ruined so many. But it was going back and sitting with any of the others that wanted to sit downstairs in the sort of hotel restaurant area. There's a beautiful big lobby there. And we just eat, I think, because it was the only time we felt you could eat, because obviously you're not going to be out there in your tiny bits of lycra feeling a little bit sick because you've just suddenly got this like massive event to do with everybody watching you. So I think we just all sit. We usually order something quite healthy. Judy Simpson, bless her, though, she was one of our best heptathletes we've ever had. She was called Nightshade, and she could just eat the planet. She could eat anything she wanted. So we're there with our chicken breasts and like broccoli, and this plate would come out with Judy's meal on it. It would be fries and burgers, and because she could literally not keep her weight on her, bless her. So, well, yeah, it was nice. That was the nice time. We'd all take the mickey out of each other, have a good laugh about the contenders that are in the show at the time, and in a nice way, because they made the show for us, you know.
Yeah. Well, and I know whose plate I'd definitely be going after, and it wouldn't be yours, Diane. I would be going after Nightshade.
Yeah, exactly. She's immense. She's just a machine.
I'm guessing you all still got very recognised in the street even after the show stopped. Does that still happen for you now? Do you still get like, Jet?
I think people are a lot cooler these days because of social media, and I think people have wised up to the fact that, you know, fame can be with anyone at any time. I think some people are still fascinated by fame, and I don't get that. I think if you're fascinated by fame, just be very careful about what it is you become famous for, because surely I call it authentic endeavor. And I think if somebody is famous because they're really good at something, or they've changed people's lives by being an amazing person, NHS workers, things like that. But it all sounds very, very, I'm sounding very kind of profound, but I'm not meaning to, but I think fame can be easily got for the wrong reasons. And I think glad we all really earned the fame that we had these days. I mean, it is 30 years on nearly, Carly, my gosh. I do wear a cap a lot. I've still kept my long hair because it keeps me warm in winter.
Any outfits in the closet still?
Yeah, do you know, I've still got four, not entire ones, but I am going to auction one for next year, and another one as well, which I'll put some of the funds towards Mind and the Samaritans, because I work as a psychotherapist. Yeah. And I just really want to support some mental health charities as well, who've had an awful, a lot of overwhelming need to be used in the last sort of couple of years. So, yes, I'm going to auction a couple of them off. Yeah,
I'm surprised you still got them. I think I probably would like try wear them every week.
Can you imagine?
Take like yearly selfies in them, see if they
would. You that now, that is gladiatorially brave. And if you've got an amazing figure still and you can still do that, I would do that, but it's not for me. I'm too embarrassed.
Do you feel like under any pressure now to still like look in a certain way because you had sort of like the pin-up era?
I don't, because I have such a normal job and I don't really do an awful lot of social media and look at me or that look at me stuff. I think because I'm 51 for once. Not that being 51 changes it for so many beautiful men and women out there. Age is completely irrelevant now with how people maintain how they look and their fitness and their well-being. They want to show it off, and why not? But for me, I've always been really quite shy of that stuff. Who would want to see this?
I mean, there's probably thousands of people right now, Diane, so I'm sure they're literally...
I think it'd be kind. If it was functional rather than just form, so if I was doing something that involved a bit of talent, not that I have an enormous amount of talent, but I can still dance, I can still move, I can't ice skate, but I'd like to learn to try. I think you know where I'm going with this.
Yes.
If I was being paid to do a job and try to learn something completely new,
like dancing on ice,
my dancing skills. Yeah, I've never done partner dancing either, but I would then, yes, get the body out and train to some high level to get the condition, but not as good as Lightning's, because she's done her bodybuilding recently and she looks phenomenal. And I know the level of work that goes into that. I mean, that's your world champion now, so from what I understand. So yeah,
I've seen some snaps of her lately. She's come into sort of press and headlines. Do you all, I'm guessing at the time, was there any sort of rivalry between the girls or between the boys? Was there any backstage feuds, or was it a happy family that we
I think because we were all sort of married and coupled up and sort of lived in our own little couple bubbles, I wasn't terribly aware of the rivalry at the time, but apparently there would have been, of course. I think when you've got a team of extremely competitive people, both the men and the women would have had, oh, I want to be able to beat her win rate at that. But to be honest, I think on an individual by individual basis, when you're out there in not very much clothing in front of millions at the end of the camera and thousands live, I think about 9,000 people we could get into the arena, the NIA, live to actually watch the shows being filmed, which created an amazing arena type atmosphere, which you can only get at some of the big concerts and pop concerts and things these days. You're really more concerned about you personally, individually looking good and winning, and not, as I said before, not getting injured. How you then compare to the others, I wouldn't kind of go, oh, I want to be as good as her or as good as him. I just needed to be my best. Own personal best, because I knew what my potential was. And if I didn't fulfill that potential, I would get angry with myself. I think there's a couple of bits of film where I don't quite get someone on a wall or something, and I'm like, doing all that as I'm being kind of hoisted down, and I go, oh, Jet's in a mood. It would have been at my own stupidity for slipping on a run or a route up the wall, which normally I would do really well. Or just the fact that the contender just was better than me that day. Do you know what I mean?
We don't like to admit that. I know we don't. But in regards to, you said that people were coupled off, you did have your own sort of little dating thing going on, if I'm right, with Hunter.
We dated for a year. And it was after before he dated Ulrika.
Yes, that's what I was going to bring up. You knew I was going to bring it up. So what happened, you were before, and I know you still keep in touch now. Here's a lovely photo of you recently. So your pals still friendly babies, aren't you? Which is great to know. What happened with you guys? Were you friends with Eureka before and then she got with him? Is there any bad blood there? Because I would probably be annoyed if my friend got with someone.
Really? I didn't know Ulrika Ali that well. We all were fairly, well, I was fairly insular. I just met the chap I was then going to be married to. James and I were together for a year, and it was after I left that we split up. I think Sharon's just to put a message through on Twitter. Oh, I think Sharon's watching. Hello. She put health and safety. Yes, we must mention health and safety. absolutely. But we split up. We were a year together. I think he was 19 and I was like 21. I mean, I'm being a cougar at 21, which is fair. But we remained good friends ever since. And it was after I'd left the show that I think they got together. I have to admit that Ulrika is one of the funniest women I think I've ever met. She is super bright, super self-evasive. I don't know if you've seen any of the stuff that she does. I can't read that, Sharon. Join test to tune in. I don't know what that means, sorry. She's just one of the funniest, wittiest people that I've ever met, and brave, I think, too. She just has this sort of Swedish courage thing going on, and she makes me laugh. She's life too seriously at all, and that's good fun by my book.
But it doesn't seem like there's any bad blood between it. That was obviously long, long forgotten. But she did do an interview recently, actually, and she did speak about her glad time.
Right.
She's obviously learning her lines for the show. She'd go back to the hotel that you mentioned, the lovely hotel. She said sometimes she might have got a bit distracted and annoyed in her room because there was a lot going on in other rooms.
She did a lot.
Yeah. I wondered if you know what I'm talking about. Did you witness any? Was it anything that you can share with us today?
Do you know, I personally wouldn't have been that aware, although I was quite young at the time, but most of us were settled. There was lots of pranks going on. I can't say about the more salacious stuff because that's people's private lives, if I knew anyway. But the pranks were funny. There was lots of initiation ceremonies. If we had a new gladiator join us one year, they'd be kind of trussed up and drawn on and shaving foam on, particularly amongst the boys. They were funny. They were up for a laugh. I think because it was really stressful, actually, in the arena. I know people say, oh, God, you were padded up. It's TV. You paid lots of money. Shut up, Di. It was stressful. There was nowhere to hide, as I've said before. And the injuries were very real. Sharon, she knows this, and anyone else listening. So the de-stress bit was when the humour came out. And I have to say, to this day, when we meet up at things like Comic Cons, which are great fun, we just sit almost crying with laughter at some of the memories that we share about how we got through the filming period. Because sometimes the filming period would be anything from 5 to 9 weeks in the early days of the show. So it was a long time, with 2 days filming on, anything from 2 to 4 days filming off, so your body got a chance to recover. And it was a massive machine for LWT, part of the ITV complex back then, to garner together and put on the road, because it would have been an expensive shoot to do. I think we had somebody quoted, was it 12 non-digital cameras? I'm sorry, I'm a bit geeky here. Non-digital cameras. So when they'd have been shooting on film, so it had 12 cameras at least live on every event that was shot, because I had to try and get every angle possible, because you wouldn't be able to retake it, because it, as I said, it was a game show. When there's money involved, you can't retake it, because then it would be set up. Yeah. So it was a huge machine of a show. And I can mention now, from cast to crew to riggers, guys in the canteen, because we'd eat them out of house and home, particularly the boys. You know, it was a massive to make up costumes. Everybody, Stephen Adner, who did Dancing on Ice costumes as well for years. Hello, Stephen, if you're watching. Just the nicest team. And it was pressurized and stressful. So, yeah, we were de-stressed by eating, laughing. The boys would play lots of pranks, and some of the girls. And as for relationships and things, I don't know. I think, obviously, I dated James for a year. We dated each other while we were there. And then he was with Ulrika afterwards, after I left. And I think everyone else was pretty much married and settled.
Yeah, well, that's not, she might have added that there was a lot of bed hopping going on.
I don't know. For me, I was with my James back then.
And eating then the chicken and broccoli. You were busy woman eating yourself.
Eating so. Chicken and broccoli, of course.
Do you ever stay in touch? Any of the glads now, apart from James that we saw? Do you stay in touch with
Kate? Kate Staples, who plays Zodiac, she not only became what I call my gladiator sister, she's still one of my besties, an incredible woman. Who she was a Olympian as well as a European hurdles pole vault, get it right, Di. Pole vault champion at the point where she actually entered the show. Sharon, of course, incredible, just the most focused lady and very beautiful inside and out. I had the wonderful opportunity just the other weekend at Bath at Comic-Con there, of sitting with one of my oldest besties, Sarah from Surrey, on one side, who is a 6-foot leggy blonde and very graceful, and then Sharon Davis on the other side, who is just gorgeous. And I just tapped myself for a moment and thought, this is so nice. I'm actually being paid to be here to meet people who loved the show, love still meeting gladiators. We had Mickey Cobra there as well, and James Hunter, of course. And they were just all sat in a line. I just sort of tapped my knee for a couple of times and thought, this is lovely. This is really nice. And it was just lovely to catch up with Sharon as well.
Well, we're hoping for next year to celebrate. There could be, come on, there's got to be something. It's 30 years. What do you think? There could be whispers going on. Have you heard any more?
Nothing. Absolutely nothing. I don't know. We've been doing the Glad Pod, which I must mention.
I've listened to the intro episode and your episode as well.
Oh, have you? Oh my gosh. Yeah. Oh, thank you very much. Yes, the Glad Pod. Well, a producer at ITV, hello David Blackmore, he approached me a couple of years ago saying, you know, everybody's stories will be so interesting, how they got on the show, what it was like for them. It's worth more than 4 minutes on airtime of any other independent or BBC, we know this. Everyone's got a nice story to tell. So we've spent the last couple of years with Paul Noddings, another producer, a lovely Paul, and David Blackmore, producer at ITV. Paul's a producer for Disney, and we, the three of us, have actually sat and amassed the Glad Pod. We haven't got everybody yet, but we've done Wolf, we've done Stephen Adnett, we've done all the main gladiators from the first series, and some of the international gladiators we've started moving on to too, which has been amazing to hear how people from all over the world were selected for this unique show,
yeah,
and what it meant to them and what it means to them now as parents and grandparents of children going, you did what, you know? Then that's been fantastic. I've absolutely loved that. So that's called The Glad Pod.
If yeah, it was, I mean, I listened to the first couple, as yours was the first one, wasn't it? They did. And you did say on there, you haven't got any really gladiator regrets, but more personal regrets.
I did, yeah.
Would you expand on that at all for us today?
Oh, golly. I'll be, was it, tactful. I think most of you, I think you can't get into your early 50s and not admit to having made some very big mistakes, and I have, and I'll admit to that. And I'm a psychotherapist and counselor, and the worst thing was during those years when things had got very dark, there may be a book one day, I don't know, because it involves other people's lives. People would say, well, you should know, Di, you're a therapist, and I'm like, yeah, but I'm not a saint, and bad things can happen to people even if they, you know, if you don't see something coming, and suddenly you're in it, and it takes an awful while to kind of think, oh crikey, I've got to get out of this, this is not safe and it's not good, and it's these are quite serious issues which affect people's lives. So I think just on that tone, Carly, yeah. I would sort of say watch this space if I ever do talk about, but it does involve other people's lives who I'm sure are a lot happier and better in themselves, but I was at risk for a while. I didn't do things as well as I ever had done, say up to my mid-30s. I'd got life very nice, thank you very much, and then things went dark for a number of years. And again, you can apportion blame to naivety naive, trusting, and thought everyone was made of good stuff and nicely brought up, to getting it terribly wrong. So you can read into that as much as you want to, yeah. I don't think there's anybody, as I said, gets to my sort of age where that may not have happened. And, you know, could you argue, because I was in the public eye and people projected lots of other things onto me, usually it's their stuff, because when we project onto somebody, it's about you, not the person that you're projecting onto. They're bringing something out in you, but it is yours, and we call it ownership. And I think it's how you deal with that. You know, these things happen, and it's then how you deal with negotiating that territory and making sure you can not run away at speed, because sometimes that's a wrong trigger for somebody who's got issues. You back away very slowly while remaining keeping eye contact and just saying, thank you for the lessons, I wish you well, get counselling, bye. I'm only a counsellor, what do I know? But it's not until you're in some situations like that that you realise, oh yikes, this isn't just something you study or help other people with, this can happen on your own doorstep, literally.
So we might hear more about this in a book one day.
Yeah, I'll write about it only if I feel, one, the people involved have gone and got themselves as much help and support to look at why they behave the ways they've behaved, as possible, so they can take ownership of it, and two, that it would help others out there, and to recognise even a strong woman like Jet from the Gladiators can sadly attract quite naively people who have hidden agendas. I don't want to say too much about it all now.
Yeah, well, I hope you're on the flip side of things and that things are bright for you. I mean,
you.
We hopefully should be seeing you next year for some sort of gladiator reunion. My fingers,
please, promise us that. Let's
across.
Do it.
Everything's crossed. But thanks so much for joining us today, Diane. It's been such an amazing experience talking to you, and I know my dad is going to be buzzing because he's so brilliant. Thanks everyone for watching.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.